this first meeting, annual meeting of the DSI Center for Open and Reproducible Science, or CORES. I'm Russ Poldrack, director of the center, really appreciate you joining us today. So I'm going to first sort of give an overview of the center, what our goals are, who's involved, and then we'll go from there. So it turns out that scientists are, you know, amongst the most trusted people, at least in the United States. These are data from April 2020. And, you know, they show that in comparison to nearly every other category of individuals, Americans place a lot of trust in scientists and medical scientists. And we think that at the heart of this trust lies the, you know, the fact that scientists aim to be transparent and to do work that's reproducible. So why does Stanford need a center that's focused on open science and reproducibility? Well, for one thing, Stanford researchers are amongst the world's leaders on these issues, as we'll see sort of throughout the day. However, early career researchers and trainees still struggle to adopt the research practices behind open science and reproducible science. So we think that we have the potential to blaze a trail at Stanford that the rest of the world will follow. And, you know, main goal of today is to think through what that looks like for us. So what do I mean by open science? I mean, fundamentally, what I mean is a set of values about how we do science. The first is transparency and accessibility, such that all of the objects of a scholarly inquiry, from the materials to the data, to the code, to the publication, should be shared as openly as possible. Second, our diversity and inclusion. We think the scientific community should be open and welcoming to all. And third is community-mindedness. We think that science should be viewed as a community effort, not as a competition or a zero-sum game, as it's often viewed in some parts of science, at least. So our goal sort of fits with the goal laid out in this report that came out from the National Academies in 2018 called Open Science by Design, which laid out a set of ideas and recommendations for how to realize, you know, open science as just science. And the first recommendation was the following: research institutions should work to create a culture that actively supports open science by design by better rewarding and supporting researchers engaged in open science practices. What do we mean by open science practices? Well, there's lots of different things that one might mean. Everything from open access publication to sharing of data openly to reproducible research, to you know, evaluation, be it with regard to peer review or with regard to things like promotion and tenure, policies, either at the organizational or the national level, and tools. And, you know, various people in our community are interested in all of these different topics. So why do we need to move towards this sort of open science landscape? Well, the National Academy report laid out a number of different ways in which openness might bring value to science. First is rigor and reproducibility. The fact that you know, we don't tell people that something is true and then a year later tell them that it's not true. Second is the ability to address new questions, right? There might be questions that one can address with data amalgamated from 10 different labs that couldn't be addressed with data from any one lab. Faster and more inclusive dissemination of knowledge. We've certainly seen this in the context of COVID-19, with the explosion of preprints in the medical research world, broader participation of research, both, you know, within our community and within the global community, effective use of resources. You know, we're relying on funding from the government and ultimately from citizens to pay for research. We should use those resources as effectively as possible, and openness allows us to do that. Improve performance of research tests. There's many different tasks that could actually be improved by the adoption of practices from the open science community. And finally, open publication for public benefit. Again, the public pays for the research. They should have access to the knowledge that accrues from that research. So why reproducibility? Why do we care about reproducibility? Well, you know, my interest, and I think many people's interest in this community, have arisen from the what's been come to be called the reproducibility crisis that's kind of grown up over the last decade, you know, starting in psychology, but really sort of extending throughout, you know, many different parts of science very generally, both biomedical, basic research, and social sciences, suggesting that, you know, many of the practices that previously had been used by researchers might not be able to actually provide us with knowledge that's robust and reproducible. My interest in particularly in computational reproducibility is sort of inspired by this quote from David Donahoe from the Stanford Statistics Department, who's really been a pioneer in research reproducibility. He said, an article about a computational result is advertising, not scholarship. The actual scholarship is the full software environment, code, and data that produce the result. Now, another, you know, I mentioned that another of our principles is diversity, inclusivity, and openness. And you might ask why, you know, what does that have to do with open science? Obviously, there are humanistic reasons that we think that diversity is a good thing, but there are also important scientific reasons. And, you know, Helen Longinot, who's an affiliate of CORES, emeritus faculty in the Stanford Philosophy Department, has been a pioneer in sort of talking about this idea. This is a quote from her 1998 book. When background assumptions are shared by all members of community, they acquire an invisibility that renders them unavailable for criticism. The greater the number of different points of view included in a scientific community, the more likely it is that its scientific practice will be objective, and it'll result in descriptions and explanations of natural processes that are more reliable than would otherwise be the case. So having a diverse community both you know, achieves the aims that we think are the right thing to do and gives us better science. So what are the barriers? Why doesn't everybody already do all this stuff? One of them is certainly cost and infrastructure, right? It takes extra time to, for example, share one's data. It can cost money to publish in an open access journal. And often there's infrastructure that, that you know, may not be available or might require a lot of work to generate. Certainly the structure, the current structure of scholarly communications is a barrier when, you know, many journals are run by for-profit companies, you know, and basically take advantage of the intellectual property of faculty members without, you know, and make a lot of money off of it. Another is the lack of supportive culture, incentives and training. And I want to focus particularly on the incentive side, because I think that's fundamentally, you know, the thing that needs to change in order to make everyone do open science. If the number one criterion for getting a job or getting tenure was, you know, how reproducible and open is one science, everybody would be doing open science tomorrow. There's, of course, privacy, security, and proprietary barriers to sharing that vary a lot across different domains of science. And finally, there's disciplinary differences. Some areas have been sharing data with each other for decades. Others still haven't come around. So I like to think of, you know, what we're trying to do as sort of solving a design problem, if you will. We want to make science work better. How do we do that? The thing you see on the left here, if I was in a room with you all, I would try to get you to guess what it is. It's a commercial paper cutter. And you'll notice that it has these two big green buttons and a foot pedal. And the buttons are there to basically prevent people from doing the sort of unfortunate thing that people tend to do when they're using a paper cutter, which is to hold the paper in with their hand and potentially cut off their finger. So this requires them to hold down both of those buttons and hit the foot pedal in order to engage the blade on the cutter. So this is what good design is about, right? Basically preventing the kind of errors that you know people will make and affording the kinds of behaviors that you want them to engage in. Now, in particular in science, it's become clear that, you know, a lot of the issue has to do with kind of human psychology, right? This editorial from Nature a few years ago noted, humans are remarkably good at self-deception, but growing concern about reproducibility is driving many researchers to seek ways to fight their own worst instincts. Another way to think about this is in terms of this concept of choice architecture that comes from behavioral economics, kind of famously laid out in this book called Nudge by Thaler and Sunstein. So the choice architecture, the concept of choice architecture is that, you know, anytime people go into a situation where they have to make choices, there's going to be particular sets of features that drive people toward or away from those particular choices. So for example, if you're using an analysis software that has a default setting for some particular parameter, you're very likely to just leave that default parameter. And if it's a good default, that's a good thing. If it's a bad default, that's probably not such a good thing. So the concept of a nudge is basically a way of modifying the choice architecture such that you try to push people towards the kinds of decisions you want them to make without sort of, you know, limiting their freedom. They can do whatever they want, but you try to incentivize or provide defaults or feedback or sort of build the system to kind of expect and prevent the sort of errors you expect to try to ultimately afford the sorts of behavior that you want to see in the world. So CORES is, sorry, I'm gonna step back and talk now about Stanford Data Science. CORES is part of Stanford Data Science, as I'll show you in a moment. And the Stanford Data Science Initiative grew out of the Stanford Long Range Vision process, which many of you were probably involved in. And the goal of Stanford Data Science, very generally, is to foster a community of the world's best data scientists to create a campus-wide ecosystem where research and education can thrive and ultimately engage the world and advance the field of data science. Stanford Data Science, these are the folks who are involved. We have a faculty director, which is Emmanuel Candes, who you'll meet later this morning. Chris Menzel, who's the executive director, and then a set of us who are associate directors who are involved in, you know, various aspects of the data science initiative. On the research side, Stanford Data Science is aiming to create a data science ecosystem and has started by providing funding for both postdocs and graduate students who are already at Stanford and to try to create strong intersections amongst both people and departments, really trying to span the entire campus. We're also trying to foster a data science culture, sort of funding both collaborations and soon new faculty between Stanford Data Science and all of the seven schools. And then really trying to overcome disciplinary boundaries. So trying to create both intellectual and ultimately when we can all be back on campus physically, physical spaces for intersection. So one of the things that Stanford Data Science is doing is providing funding for CORES as well as for another center that I'll mention. And ultimately we want to build a complex for data science and computational research in the area between Gates and Sequoia Hall. So there's a number of initiatives that are being driven by Stanford Data Science. One that you may have heard of is the Stanford, the Data Science for Social Good program run by Kiara Sabati. This is a summer program to engage students in projects that are really aiming to use data science to advance various social projects. There's also the Women in Data Science project run by Margot Gerritsen, which is sort of supported by SDS. Margot is part of the leadership of SDS, which is really aiming to develop an open, inclusive community for data science globally. And then there's two centers that are currently funded by SDS. The first is the Stanford Causal Science Center, SC2, run by Guido Imbens, which is focused on development and training of causal inference methods. And then there's CORES, which you're learning about today. So let me tell you a little bit about who we are, who's involved. So the leadership is myself as director, my Mather from the medical school as associate director, Franklin Feingold, who many of you have heard from in the process of this meeting, is our director of operations. And then Chris Menzel, who is the SDS executive director, has also been deeply involved in sort of the building and design of CORES. We have an executive committee that spans a number of different departments across campus, as well as a number of different administrative units in the libraries and BPDOR. And this group is really helping us kind of, design the mission and the aims of CORES. We have a growing set of both faculty and staff and student affiliates. And if you'd like to be on this slide and are not, we'd love to have you join us. So you can email us at openscience@stanford.edu and we'll get you involved. We'd like to have as big of a community as possible. We also have an external advisory board that we are engaging to try to help us think about how to move forward in the best way possible and how to engage the rest of the world. It's an international group with people obviously from the US as well as Mexico, Canada, and the UK, some of whom are here with us today. So we have really three areas of focus within CORES. The first is, you know, focused on open science, really. How do we make science as transparent and openly available as possible? The second is reproducibility. How do we give people the tools that they need to make their research be as robust and reproducible as possible? And the third is evidence synthesis. How do we bring together evidence across many studies to understand the reproducibility of research and ultimately understand, you know, what we can take away from larger bodies of research? So CORES is engaged currently in a number of different activities. The first, which you're going to learn more about later today, are awards that we're giving out with the goal of incentivizing and, you know, sort of recognizing people who've been involved in open science activity. These are our Champion and Innovator Awards. We'll have an award ceremony at 3:20 this afternoon, so hopefully you'll join for that. The second is a handbook that we're going to call Open by Design at Stanford. This is going to be an openly available web handbook that really provides sort of hands-on guidance to anybody who wants to implement open science or reproducible research practices. And one of the aims is to have examples of all of these practices from a broad range of Stanford scholars. We're also going to be engaging going forward in a set of hackathons, or what you might call docuthons, documentation sprints, where we want to get, you know, members of the community engaged in an extended way in the development of resources and tools to help enable open and reproducible science. And finally, we hope in the future to start doing basically open science consulting, just in the same way that the statistics department now provides statistical consulting. We want to provide consulting to people in how to implement these practices in their kind of daily research lives. And one thing we plan on doing is sort of an open science office hour where anybody can show up and get help on those issues. So here's today's agenda. We're gonna have three keynote talks starting right after I'm done here with Mercedes Rosas. We'll have a panel discussion at 10:55 with leaders from campus talking about kind of where things stand at Stanford in terms of the state of open science. We'll have Fernando Perez at 11:45 from Berkeley. We'll have a short lunch break. And then at 1:20, we're going to do breakout sessions. I'll say more about those in a moment. At 2:20, we'll have the third keynote from David Moore from Ottawa Hospital Research Institute. We'll have our award ceremony. And then finally, we'll have a kind of a discussion panel led by Monica Bobra on basically a number of issues in open science with, again, you know, people from across campus who are engaged in various ways. So the breakout sessions will cover various topics, and the goals of these is really to, one, kind of figure out what the main challenges are in, you know, in doing open science, and also to kind of bring people together to have some action items to go forward and really start working together on addressing these main challenges that come out of the discussion. So I hope that you'll kind of, you know, pick one of these, join in, and then, you know, hopefully going forward, it'll really galvanize our community to start working together to address a number of these issues. So we have about 9 minutes before we're scheduled to have Dr. Kostas start her keynote. I'm happy to take any questions that anybody wants to type in. Otherwise, we'll take a short break.